Now I think we'll be moving to the most power-packed session, which we always have, the lung session. So I'd like to hand over to the senior most chairperson, Dr. Shyam Agarwal sir from Gangaram Hospital, and Dr. Bharti sir from SN Medical College, Jodhpur. Respected sirs, please take over and take over the power-packed lung session. Dr. Bharti sir and Dr. Shyam Agarwal sir, please.
Yeah. So good evening, everybody. Thank you, Sumant. Along with the co-chairperson, Dr. Bharti, we welcome you to this lung session, which is really interesting because several new things have emerged over the last one decade or so in the management of non-small cell lung cancer and even in small cell lung cancer. And I think the opening batsman has a trick down his sleeve, as he always has, who is none other than Ullas Batra. So I don't need to, you know, say too much. And over to Ullas for immunotherapy tips, you know. So I think we all know the theory. So what you are doing in your practice, I think kindly highlight that for our learning. And we'll appreciate that. So over to Dr. Ullas from Rajiv Gandhi. Thank you very much. And maybe Dr. Bharti wants to say a few words before Ullas begins.
Welcome, Dr. Ullas. You go ahead. You are the master of the lung cancer. Go ahead, kindly.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Chairperson. And thank you, Shyam Agarwal, sir, for the wonderful introduction. Although I think there is a bit of Saturday night feeling in that introduction, actually. And and you know it, sir, you know. So I will get back to you, sir, in some panel or other on that. Okay, so I have been asked to speak about the next immunotherapy strategies in lung cancer. And my first reactions when I actually read the topic for the first time and I called up Sumant on the morning of Holi was this, you know, I mean, there must be some mistake. I mean, next immunotherapy strategy, I mean, from my point, you know, the current status of immunotherapy in lung cancer, to me at least, is like lost, confused, unsure. We are still not very unclear about it. I am disoriented sometimes, bewildered by why some trials are positive, negative. And here we are talking about the next, you know, next therapy of immunotherapy session in lung cancer. So let's see what we have. So before I speak about the next immunotherapy status, let's talk about the current status of immunotherapy in lung cancer. So lung cancer can be divided into two, non-small cell, small cell. Non-small cell, stage 1, 2, 3, 4, small cell into localized extensive. And please look at the last thing in which in stage 1, 2, there is no role of immunotherapy. In stage 3, you have an established role of conservative radiotherapy. In stage 4, you have a huge role of immunotherapy. In localized small cell, there is no role. Extensive, you have a role in combination with chemo. So let me start by saying, the next immunotherapy strategy in lung cancer, let me start off with saying with stage 1 and stage 2 lung cancer. Now, these are uncharted territories, Shyam Agarwal, sir, because none of, I'm going to speak about what is probably going to come in 2025 and 2030. So, we always start with why. You know, I mean, this is my favorite book. I mean, Simon Sinek book. So please go ahead and read this book. You should always start with why exactly. Do you want to have immunotherapy in the early stage and lung cancer? So why do we need to have this strategy in early stage lung cancer? Because even in stage 1B, you have 45% of people who will recur. And in stage 3, you have 76% of people who will recur in spite of having the fantastic surgery, radiotherapy, and the chemotherapy that we give right now. So this is the role or impact of chemotherapy in stage 1, 2, 3 non-small cell lung cancer. Please look at the graph, the difference between the orange and the blue and the red and the blue. I mean, it's an absolutely minuscule difference that the chemotherapy has actually made in the treatment of early stage lung cancer. This is about the new adjuvant at the adjuvant. And, you know, Senthil Rajappa has made the HR ratios very famous. And we are looking at an HR of 0.55, 0.56. Look at the HR ratio of neoadjuvant and adjuvant chemotherapy, 0.87 and 0.86. That means there are a lot of people who get unnecessary adjuvant and neoadjuvant chemotherapy. The difference is very, very minuscule. So the potential benefit from systemic therapy in lung, small cell lung cancer is only this. these are the patients who are cured with local regional therapy, and these are the patients who are will never be cured with adjuvant therapy. So this is, you know, how medical oncologists are there in the early stage non-small cell lung cancer. We, you know, we go out, we have a cup of coffee because we know nothing used to happen. So early stage lung cancer also need our help. And we all know immunotherapy, non-small cell lung cancer, like the Avengers, you know, I mean, you have all the superheroes and all. So can this superhero salvage the early stage lung cancer? So this was the first paper where immunotherapy went and made its first foray into resectable lung cancer. So please look at the graph over here. When neoadjuvant chemotherapy, only single agent nivolumab was given. The result in this trial, small trial, 21 patient trial, it said that only single agent nivolumab was sort of few side effects. It did not delay surgery and a major pathological response in 45% of the people. So these were what I call as baby steps of immunotherapy into early stage lung cancer. Now, there are a lot of trials of immunotherapy alone or immunotherapy. I've put a list of the papers. And if you look at the major pathological response rate from anywhere between 14 to 45% major pathological response and a PCR rate of somewhere around 5 to 10 to 15%. This is only with immunotherapy. Please look at this. Now, there are always cynics who will say, so what if the tumor progresses? Please note that the progression rate of lung cancer and immunotherapy is hardly anything, 3%, 4%, 5%. So this was only about immunotherapy. But can we do better? Because we always believe that it takes two to tango. So what is the role of immunotherapy and chemotherapy? So initially, I spoke only about immunotherapy. Now let's look at the chemo-immuno strategies in early stage lung cancer. And if you look at this graph over here, remember, with only single agent immunotherapy, you had a 40% rate of major pathological response. But if you combine immunotherapy and chemotherapy, you have a response rate of 60%, 83%, 57%, and downshading occurred in 68 to 90% of the tumors. So how do you choose? Are you alone or IO plus chemotherapy, neoadjuvant therapy, non-small cell lung cancer? Look at the last thing. If you give immunotherapy, monotherapy in stage 3A patient, you have a major pathological rate probably of a 23.4%, a PCR rate of 7.5%. But if you give immunotherapy and chemotherapy, you have a 64.7% major pathological response rate, 36.7% PCR rate, and a downstaging which occurs in 74% of people. This is also one slide which is showing by and large the same thing. So this was what was the past and the present. So look at the initial neoadjuvant trials. You know, a response rate of 62% on the top, 35%, 60%, PCR rate of 3%, 8%, and the bottom two graphs, OS of 89% at 24 months and a PFS of 27.24 months is absolutely fantastic, actually. So this is very, very, very interesting, actually. And is there a biomarker to predict response of immunotherapy in early stage lung cancer? Sadly, there is no response. Nivolumab, atezolizumab, pembrolizumab, there is no relation to PD-L1 that if somebody's PD-L1 is positive or negative, somebody will respond to immunotherapy. So I initially showed you the baby steps of nivolumab and this thing, but I'm sure immunotherapy and chemotherapy, the baby has learned to dance right now. So as new adjuvant approach, I think they're very, very good. So that was about the next immunotherapy strategies in stage 1-2. Now let's look at the stage 3 lung cancer. These are the three approaches in which we can give, the Pacific trial actually, in which durvalumab was given after CTRT. And this was a huge benefit which was there from the durvalumab. So these are the three approaches in which we can give integrated immunotherapy in stage 3 lung cancer. You can give chemotherapy RT and then consider it with immunotherapy. That's a Pacific approach. You can start with CTRT immunotherapy and then give immunotherapy consolidation. That was the Keynote 799 and the Nicholas approach. You can then go for chemo induction, CTRT plus minus immunotherapy. That has not yet been tested. So now, look at the trial over here. Typically, we give durvalumab after chemotherapy. Again, nivolumab had an early foray. Please look at the red light, the box inside that. Nivolumab was started in along with chemotherapy and radiotherapy. So you give one cycle chemotherapy, then you give RT and nivo and chemo immuno combination. And this was the PFS and the OS which was reported. The pneumonitis, which was very, very of a concern, only 7 by 79% of the patient had a grade 3 pneumonitis. So this was tolerable. This was presented at ASCO 2020. Here, pembrolizumab was compared, was added in addition to chemotherapy along with radiotherapy. So you're giving chemo, immuno, and RT all together. And this also showed an overall response rate of 67%, 56%, and a very impressive 6 months and OSP. The major issue rate is here is tolerability. Now, does this drug also cause more pneumonitis if it is given together? Again, what we know is chemo-immuno definitely can be given along with pembrolizumab with a grade 3 pneumonitis rate of only 8 and 5.5%. So this drug can definitely be given. So moving beyond PACIFIC, what is the next immunotherapy strategy with concurrent chemo radiation? I would give it a 3 by 5. The response rates are good. The tolerability is okay, but the OS has not really improved drastically. So probably the OS has improved only by 1 or 2. So according to my opinion, this is a 3 on 5 actually in the, as a next immunotherapy chat. So we spoke about stage 1, 2, where I showed the baby was dancing. Stage 3, where the baby was 3 by 5. Now let's look at stage 4 lung cancer, in which the immunotherapy has an established role over here. And my first reaction on stage 4 also, are you kidding me? I mean, you want to improve immunotherapy in stage 4 also? And then I looked at this graph, you know. I mean, you know, we say huge things about chemo-immunotherapy in first line and all, but please look at the KEYNOTE-24. Only 32% of people are alive at 5 years. So probably 68% of people won't respond to immunotherapy, and that is why we need more from here. Now, this is something to bore you. Why does tumor escape? Because the T cells are not able to infiltrate the tumors. T cells are not able to recognize the antigens. T cells, even if they antagonize the, if they go inside, they can have deficient functional activity. They can have an impaired antigen presentation, or you can have a lot of alteration in the interferon signaling path. So what do? You combine immunotherapy with bispecific, multispecific, with epigenetic, with chemo ADC, with DNA repair agents, with anti-angiogenesis, novel IO antibodies. Are not going to bore you along with this. I saw Dr. Sanjay Sharma was very interested sitting in the front of his chair. Now he's taken a back seat, but I'm going to bore him with this approach. I'm just going to show you one drug which was presented at ASCO 2020, which was the TIGIT. That was the TIGIT and the atezolizumab frontline. Now, this is a T-cell immune receptor with IG and IgM domains. Now, this is an antibody with an intact Fc region that blocks the binding of TIGIT's to its receptor PVR. And this was a fantastic result, which was there in PDL more than 50%. So if you give if Adizo alone, that's the blue one. And if you give TG plus Adizo, that is Dr. Shyam Agarwal's knowledge, but in my knowledge, and you know, that is superb. But please note and read in between the lines that if you have 1 to 49%, there was no benefit of adding digitalizumab plus atezolizumab. Another drug, which is lenvatinib and pembrolizumab, which has created huge improvement in endometrial carcinomas and stomach carcinomas, lung cancer also is being studied for. Now, this is also a trial. I have purposefully, kept it that don't get swayed by all the new names that I am showing you. This was a phase 2 trial, which was combining an interleukin-2 plus an anti-PD-1 inhibitor. We were showing a great response. The interleukin was actually better. But when this was compared in a randomized control trial, there was no benefit of adding interleukin-2 to our immunotherapy. This was also, I think Dr. Sanjay Sharma has. Can you see my screen?
No, sir. Can you please reshare the screen?
Yeah, I will do that. Okay. So I think I'm going to. Okay, so this was also, we are very fond of talking immunotherapy plus Nivo plus Ipi. Now, this was a trial where Pembro was combined to ipilimumab. And this was the KEYNOTE-598 trial. And this trial basically showed that there was no benefit of adding ipilimumab to pembrolizumab, and absolutely no difference between OS and the PFS. So this was definitely a reality bite for all of us. Stage 4 non-small cell lung cancer. So my rating over here, next immunotherapy strategies in stage 4 lung cancer is probably, all the immunotherapy agents right now are like in 2008, we are adding somewhere. But which of them goes on to become Hrithik Roshan and which of them goes on to become Harman Babeja in 2025, I do not know at present. We will have to wait and watch for the best answer and we'll have to see which strategy is the best. So then we spoke about all this. Let's speak about small cell lung cancer. In localized small cell lung cancer, there is no role of immunotherapy, but there are a lot of studies which are again going ahead where we are adding radiotherapy and immunotherapy. All these trials, again, adding nivolumab to a concurrent CTRT in small cell lung cancer is not of any benefit. So small cell lung cancer definitely is not going to budge and change. So my conclusions, next immunotherapy strategies in lung cancer, early stage and locally advanced operable lung cancer, we have made massive progresses, new adjuvant therapy, and we definitely are going to have a probably approval for all these drugs. In locally advanced and operable non-small cell lung cancer, we have made small progress. There is no major gain in survival as yet. Toxicity is slightly higher, but manageable. In stage 4 NSCLC, beyond immunotherapy, there is no major progress, but it is definitely exciting times ahead. Small cell lung cancer is a tough nut to crack. Immunotherapy has not really gone ahead and made anything. So my conclusions, I always want to end with a picture as my conclusion. So I have two pictures for everyone for next immunotherapy strategies. The roads are lovely, dark and deep, but we have promises to keep, but definitely miles to go before we sleep. As far as immunotherapy is concerned, either you can look at this or you can have this as your caption saying nothing is easy, but definitely everything is possible. 10 years back, I remember Dr. Sanjay Sharma telling me a lung cancer WCLC used to be once in 2-3 years. Now we are having a lung cancer symposium, a power pack symposium at every of our meeting. So to me, I belong to the right side that it's not easy, but definitely it's possible. And definitely immunotherapy is going to play a huge role in the management of non-small cell lung cancer. With this, I will end my slide by saying there's hope in lung cancer and looking forward to a day where lung cancer can have a cure too. Thank you. Thank you for a patient hearing. I'll be happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Ullas, for giving a nice presentation which clears everything in the lung cancer, the role of the immunotherapy. And now I will tell the audience that any questions for the Ullas. Any questions? No questions?
Then we have a question, sir.
Okay.
So I have a question for Dr. Hemant Malhotra. How can he look so nice at 7 o'clock in the evening, all suited, booted and everything, sir? It's very difficult. Sir, you have to mute yourself. Unmute yourself.
मैं कह रहा हूँ उल्लास तेरे को सुबह से कोई मिला कि नहीं आप शाम अग्रवाल
तो उल्लास the question is IO versus IO chemo the two cycles what do you think
the checkmate 9LA is very impressive sir I mean the problem with only single agent IO or IO is that you know the early progressors And recently, the CheckMate 9LA OS data has been released and there is an approval for that. So I'll be very keen. But the problem is not IO versus two cycles. The problem is Keynote 189 versus CheckMate 9LA, sir. The problem is there is no difference between two cycles and four cycles, sir. So if somebody can take Pembro plus chemo, why give CheckMate 9LA? So it's not a question of IO versus. This is a question of Keynote 189 versus CheckMate 9LA. But that's definitely better than IO or a single agent IO.
Thank you. So I think discussion is on. So Dr. Bharti, please.
Yes, next speaker is Dr. Hemant Malhotra. He's the well-known oncologist of the country and presently he's a director of oncology and the head of department of medical oncology, Mahatma Gandhi Medical College, Jaipur. He will talk on the optimizing the treatment of first-line non-small cell lung cancer, Dr. Malhotra.
Thank you very much, Honorable Chairpersons, my two very dear friends, Dr. Shyam Agarwal and Dr. Girdhar Singh Bhati. So if I am permitted to share my slides. And this session is actually sponsored by Roche. So I'll be covering primarily one of their important studies. And can you see my slides?
Yes.
Okay, great. So here goes So I'm going to be talking about only first-line treatments of patients who do not have targetable mutations. And I bring you greetings from my medical college hospital and thanks very much to the organizers for this opportunity. And this is what I'm intend to do in the next 15 minutes, give you a little bit of background, tell you about the evolving landscapes of lung cancer treatment, the current first line management, which is approved, and then focus quite a lot on the Empower 150 study, talk about subgroups of the drug in liver metastasis and patients who have EGFR positive non-small cell lung cancer who have progressed on targeted treatment, and then summarize for you. Some facts about lung cancer, heterogeneous disease, different natural history of diseases, different response rates. The non-small cell part of the lung cancer is much, much more common than small cell, 80 to 85%. Also keep in mind that 15% could be never smokers, usually a disease of old people, six or the seventh decade. Metastasis occurs early and at diagnosis, almost or maybe more than half of the patients will have distant mets. And the present targeted agents have improved survival in this subset of patients. When Shyam Agarwal and myself and Dr. Bhattacharya started oncology, we had a rare patient living beyond 1 year. But now with our current regimes, almost 15 to 20% patients can be alive 5 years after diagnosis. So we have moved quite a lot from just deciding non-small cell and small cell and giving treatment. We now have histological subtypes. We are looking at molecular pathology and molecular markers. And since the past 5 years, which Olas has very beautifully summarized, we have the checkpoint inhibitors and cancer immunotherapy coming up in a big way in lung cancers. So from being one disease in the 80s and 90s, we have moved to looking at markers in lung cancer, particularly the adenocarcinoma variety. And if you have a driver mutation, which happens in about one third of the patients, you have a whole bunch of targeted therapies now, which has been proven to be more beneficial than chemotherapy in head-to-head comparison. And you can see for the ALK, EGFR mutations and the less common mutations, you have targets for most of these mutations. And you know, this big chunk of the pie, almost one third of the patients, as of today, we don't know the driver mutations, but I'm 100% sure that before in the next 5 years, we will catch more and more genes in this group and have targeted therapies for those. So let's talk about patients of non-small cell lung cancer who do not have a target to attack. And this is some data on efficacy in the second line of immunotherapeutic drugs. The Oak trials, you know, are the atezolizumab trials, significant difference in survival as compared to chemotherapy. Sorry. Similarly for the Pembro trials and similarly for the Nevo trials when compared to chemotherapy in the second line. You know, summary of the NCCN recommendations, patients who have the targets, we know what to do. The patients who do not have the targets and a very high PD-L1 expression, more than 50, you could think of immunotherapy, pembrolizumab alone. And people who have a low PD-L1 expression or in which the PD-L1 is unknown or negative, you have an option of giving pembro plus chemo or giving this combination of atezo plus chemo plus bevacizumab. And today I'm going to focus and tell you some little bit of details about this combination and this pivotal study. And this is the Empower 150 study. The rationale for combining these three agents, two targeted agents and chemotherapy is this. In addition to its anti-angiogenic effects, we know that bevacizumab inhibition of VEGF has immune modulation. And when this is combined with an immune checkpoint inhibitor, then the cancer cell killing is enhanced. And that is the reason why this study was designed and tested in the clinic. And this is the study design for you, patients of stage 4 or recurrent metastatic non-squamous non-small cell lung cancers who were chemo naive. The stratification was by sex, by PD-L1 IHC expression, and by liver metastasis. So please note that patients who had or did not have liver metastasis were primarily stratified right at the beginning. More than 1,200 patients, 1:1:1 randomization into three arms. Arm A is atezo plus chemotherapy, followed by atezo maintenance. Arm B, atezo plus chemotherapy plus VEGF inhibitor bevacizumab, maintenance atezo plus bevacizumab. And arm C is what we usually use in chemo, in this group of patients today, or maybe the standard of care arm, that is Bev plus chemotherapy. So these were some of the subgroups which we need to know about. Intention to treat wild type of patients who did not have the EGFR ALK mutation. And there were 13% of patients who did progress on EGFR inhibitors and ALK inhibitors. They were also included in the study. And we will see the results of this later on. Patients were also analyzed with T effector cell high wild type, T effector cell low wild type. The primary objectives of the study was PFS in the intention to treat wild type population, and PFS in the T cell, T effector cell high versus low, and also the overall survival. Here are the three subgroups for you. And you can see that with respect to most of the features like age, sex, performance status, smoker, non-smoker, liver mets, about 13% to 14% in all the three arms had liver mets, EGFR, ALK mutation, all the subgroups were pretty well balanced. And here are the results for you. The progression-free survival in the intention to treat population, and there is a statistically significant improvement in arm B versus arm C, meaning the arm B, just to recapitulate for you, is atezo plus Bev plus chemotherapy, 8.3 months versus 6.8 months, which is bevacizumab plus chemotherapy, hazard ratio of 0.59 and a p-value of less than 0.0001. So significantly positive study. Also in this study, there was a statistically significant difference between arm B and arm C with respect to overall survival. So at 2 years, 43% of patients in arm B, which is atezo plus Bev plus chemo, were alive versus 33% in the Bev chemo arm. And this hazard ratio was 0.87, and again, a significant p-value. If you compare here is the overall survival and the progression-free survival, both the curves together for you. So this study, the IMpower150 study, was a positive study, and it showed a difference, a statistically significant difference in both overall survival and progression-free survival. Now, if you look at the three arms compared together and the overall objective response rates, you can see these blue bars in the center, which is arm B, which is a combination of atezo plus Bev plus chemo. You can see that the response rates with the three agent combination was better as compared to the other two comparative arms. So ladies and gentlemen, when you are deciding chemotherapy for a patient with non-small cell metastatic disease, you usually take these factors into consideration: the disease status and patient characteristics. Of course, this includes the performance status of the patient, age, comorbidities, whether the patient has CNS mets or not, and how much of tumor does the patient have. You, of course, make sure that you don't have a target. You also look at the PD-L1. Tumor mutational burden is also now coming up. And then other factors, especially the social and economic factors in our country particularly, are extremely important. So let's talk about these two subgroup of patients, which are always a problem for oncologists: patients with liver metastasis and patients who have the target, either EGFR or ALK, and who have progressed on the EGFR TKIs. So let's talk about patients with liver metastasis. First, we know that patients who have liver metastasis, this is the red curve. These patients fare significantly worse as compared to metastasis at other sites. And also patients who have liver metastasis also have many more metastatic sites. So basically this is a bad prognostic subgroup of patients. And if you do the subgroup analysis of the IMpower 150 study, you find that this is the intention to treat hazard ratio of the whole population, and this is the hazard ratio of patients who had liver mets. So a hazard ratio of 0.54. So almost a 46% improvement in progression-free survival if you combine atezo with Bev with chemotherapy versus Bev with chemotherapy alone. And if you compare the third arm, only immunotherapy with chemotherapy, that again doesn't do very well. The best results and significant results with a very healthy hazard ratio is a combination of Bev plus atezo plus chemo in patients who have liver metastasis. Now, what about the other subgroup of patients, patients who have a target, but they have progressed on EGFR targeted treatment? We know like this is the PFS with the various first generation, second generation and third generation agents which are available to us. We are also aware that patients who have EGFR mutated disease across immunotherapy trials, the benefit is, there is no benefit or there is much less benefit as compared to patients who have EGFR wild type. In the IMpower 150 study, they had about 13% of patients, 100 plus patients who had EGFR ALK positive disease who had progressed on first line TKI. And here you can see that the hazard ratio was 0.54, which was again a little better or significantly better than the intention to treat hazard ratio. So this is again a signal and that in this poor prognostic subset, the addition of bevacizumab to immunotherapy, chemotherapy backbone and does provide significant benefit. And here are the survival curves for you. This is the curve, overall survival curve of Bev, atezo, chemo versus Bev plus chemo. And this is atezo chemo versus Bev plus chemo. So the best results are in the combination of Bev, atezo, and chemo. Now, what about toxicity seen in this study? This is the most successful arm or arm of interest. Almost all the patients in all the three arms had some of the other toxicity, but grade 3 to 4 adverse events were about 50%, maybe 60% over here in the three combination arm. Almost 60% over here. So, you know, not very huge difference in the toxicities, not very huge difference in grade 5 SAEs, and not very huge difference in patients who were withdrawn for treatment in either of the three arms. If you talk about some selected immunotherapy toxicities with atezolizumab, and this is a combination of urinary bladder and non-small cell lung cancer studies, more than 2,600 patients, pneumonitis of about 3%, hepatitis of about 10%, and hypothyroidism of about 5%. So we are, you know, very familiar with these toxicities and we are used to dealing, anticipating, and preventing these toxicities. So if I were to conclude last two or three slides, the IMpower 150 is a positive study in first line non-squamous, non-small cell lung cancers, with statistically significant and clinically meaningful improvements in both co-primary endpoints, which is overall survival and progression-free survival. This clinical benefit was particularly important and striking in patients who had liver metastasis at baseline. This again, we know, is a poor prognostic group of patients, and also in patients who had EGFR ALK genomic alterations post-progression to one line of treatment, and we know that immunotherapy chemotherapy combinations is usually is not very effective in this subgroup of patients. Safety profile of this combination is quite acceptable and it is consistent with known safety risks. And additional patient characteristics beyond PD-L1 expression may be considered by making chemoimmunotherapy decisions in patients with non-small cell, non-squamous patients. And this is the first international study, open label, three-arm study, comparing these three arms together. It does demonstrate significant meaningful overall survival in EGFR mutated patients and in patients with liver metastasis. It nearly doubles PFS at 12 months with the other two arms, which we have discussed. So here is the summary again, the intention to treat population, 19 months, EGFR mutated patients not reached, liver metastasis 13 months as compared to only 9.4 months when this three drug combination is not used. And ladies and gentlemen, this combination is not only approved in USA and Europe, it is also approved in our country for use for us as and when there is the right patient. And with that, I'd like to thank you very much. I'm happy to take any questions if there is any time. I'm going to stop sharing my slides now. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Hemant, for delivering your speech in the inimitable style. So the question is, if the patient does not have a target and the PD-L1 is unknown or zero, do you discuss with an adenocarcinoma patient utility of immunotherapy?
Yeah, I think so. With the present data which we have, particularly from this new study, and the approvals which we have, it is imperative on our part to discuss with the patient. Like at least in my practice, very unlike your practice, Shyam, a very, very small number of patients who can, you know, arrange the finances for this combination. But it is imperative on our part to discuss this with the patient.
Thank you. Dr. Bharti, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Hemant. Now we will move to the next talk, that is the evolution of the lung cancer treatment, surgeon's perspective. For that, I invite Dr. Ramakant Deshpande. He is the chairperson of the executive chairman of the Asian Cancer Institute of Mumbai. Dr. Deshpande.
Good evening, Dr. Deshpande here. Can I share my screen, please? My today's topic is basically a very general one. It's an evolution of lung cancer treatment, a surgeon's perspective, how we have reached where we are right now. So this is almost like a summary of what is happening in the overall world for the development of the thoracic surgery itself. There is a lot of heroism here. There's a lot of foolishness also. But there's a lot of aggression, grit, and determination which has seen us through. Now, how have we really reached where we have reached in thoracic surgery? There's a lot of major surgery which is being done. So the advances in anesthesia, ventilation, double lumen endotracheal tube, critical care understanding has helped us quite a lot. The surgical technique, particularly the closed chest tube drainage, the imaging techniques of the CT scan is as recent as 1970. The PET CT scan is as recent as only maybe about 30 years of back. And the EBUS is barely about 25 years back. The understanding of pulmonary anatomy has happened over the past 300 to 400 years. This is very, very important. Establishment of acceptable mortality rates following pulmonary understanding since the early 1900s. Emergence of video-assisted thoracic surgery almost a century late, and that is along with the development of laparoscopic surgery in the 1980s, development of robotic surgery after 2002, and ultimately the understanding of multimodality treatment, what we have been hearing right now since the late 1900s. The latest kid on the block is the role of lung cancer screening by LDCT and catching it young. If you really see lung cancer surgery, now ultimately the history of lung cancer treatment is primarily surgical. At least those where we are still talking in terms of cure, we still talk in terms of lung resections. And lung resection was thought to be impossible until the 1200. Unfortunately, we do not have any innate Indian history for a very long time. So we have to rely upon the Western history itself. Rolandus was the published, he's the person who published the first documented case of successful lung resection in 1499. Mind you, this is almost about over 500 years back. And this was a citizen of Bologna on the sixth day after he had a hissing wound in the chest where the lung had actually come out. That one was excised. And that was reported as a successful first resection of lung itself. Then you have the war history of Ambroise Paré, and there's very similar kind of cases have been reported, multiple excisions. Unlike what a surgeon does today, that he goes to meet the lung inside the chest cavity. There, actually the lung would come out of the chest to meet the surgeon, and that is how it actually all started. In 1821, the American surgeon Milton Anthony performed one of the first resections of chest wall with lung. This is where he actually landed up going inside the chest cavity. This is one of the first cases which has been reported. The first case of successful lung resection for a tumor and not traumatized lung was reported by Pian in 1861 by Hughes, and he removed that part of the lung was by galvanic current cautery. They always found that it was easier to operate a tumorous lung because the rest of the lung would be normal there. And in case of an inflammatory lesion, you could not really put a finger very easily because there were a lot of adhesion inside. And it was Schmidt who started actually ligating the pulmonary vessels and bronchi en masse initially, but then explored individual ligation of hilar structures, a practice which is continued even today. The real improvement actually started in 1886 when an Italian internist, Forlanini, recommended artificial pneumothorax for pulmonary collapse as the best treatment for tuberculosis. This was the first recorded kind of an incidence where a disease was being treated. All the time earlier, it was basically done either for a traumatic case or because of an inherent infection itself. But here it was done as a definitive treatment by Forlanini. The Swedish pulmonologist Jacobius actually invented thoracoscopy in 1913-15, and he used actually a cystoscope, and he defined how exactly minimally invasive surgery should be done. All through the 1890s, the animal research continued with emphasis on the necessity of independent ligation of hilar structures, try to separate them if possible, exploration of pathogenesis of adhesions, visceral and parietal pleura, and use of antisepsis, etc. As you remember, no major antibiotics were available at that particular time, and hence all that was being done was use of iodine and so on and so forth. In 1891 was the first successful lung resection by a French surgeon called Tufia for tuberculosis, and he's the first man who used chloroform anesthesia, which means that he must have put an incision in the chest wall, left the chest open, and through the second interspace he approached the lung and he took the lung out using the cautery and cutting and stitching and all that kind of what we would say was a messy kind of a procedure. But mind you, this patient was able to climb stairs on eighth post-operative day and be presented at a surgical meeting. Those days, actually, you had to present your patient. If he's alive, he would go to a clinical meeting himself, unlike what happens in today's day and time. In 1895, McEwen performed the first successful pneumonectomy, removing a complete lung. Early 1900s, what used to happen is in case of lung surgery, they used to say that we will do it in two stage. So they would resect the chest wall, allow the chest wall to collapse. Then a week later, they would mobilize that lung. The hilum was clamped and they never cut that particular lung, but individually ligate the vessels and the bronchi, allow the lung to necrose, and then they would take it off. It appears very messy, but please understand there was hardly any anesthesia available those days. There were no instruments to speak about, and there were no trained surgeons, no knowledge of anatomy, and these pioneers actually did a lot of things. So, as I mentioned in the beginning of my talk, a lot of foolishness was definitely seen. In 1925, Graham described a multiple-stage pneumonectomy. using a cautery, and he actually his series was described with a mortality of 52% in 48 patients, which he had done for bronchiectasis with pulmonary resection. In 1931, the first large series of 212 lobectomies with 33% deaths and a little less than half of them cured for bronchiectasis was recorded, and they were the first to emphasize the anatomical dissection of vessels and bronchi. 1933, Graham himself actually published the first complete pneumonectomy for a lung cancer, and here starts actually the history of lung resections for cancer itself. 1939, Adams, who was ahead of his time as well, recommended endotracheal anesthesia and intercostal incision and a posterior thoracic drainage, not much different from what we do today. He controlled the hilum with a snare, actually, like what we do in case of a polyp, amputated the distal lung and sutured the vessels and bronchus separately. Very, very similar to what is being done nearly 100 years later now. In 1939, Churchill and Belsey described a technique for resection of lingua of the left upper lobe, an important emphasis on the segment and not the lobe. This is very important because these are the people who actually emphasized that a lobe is merely a segment of lung bounded by more or less constant and complete external fissure. So they said that a lobe is essentially many segments together. It has no identity of its own. And that's why they actually started emphasizing that bronchopulmonary segment may replace the lobe as a surgical unit of the lung. This is very important because all the talk of like segmentectomy today goes into that particular time. Second World War actually saw a lot of development. Thoracic surgery evolved as specialty because a lot of many of the soldiers had chest injuries, so you needed people who could actually handle it as a specialty. Most difficulties in anatomic understanding, dissections of lobe, etc., were overcome because human specimens in millions were actually available at that particular time. And if you're really interested in learning, you could learn it on live bodies rather than on dead bodies. In 1947, Overholt and Langer furthered the idea of bronchopulmonary segment. So apart from getting it from the lung lobectomy, now we are coming down to the segmentectomy itself. Thomas in 1956 reported segmentectomy in three patients with carcinoma who lived for a long period of time. It was in 1955 when technical advances started taking place. We knew that yes, surgery can be done. Now, do we really ligate it? Stapling device was first used for lung resections by the Russian surgeons, and it was actually improved again further by 1961. In 1962, Salzer was the first scientist who demonstrated that lobectomy is equivalent to pneumonectomy as far as bronchial carcinoma is concerned. So this is barely 50 years back that we have started doing lobectomies as standard of care. And now it has become a commonly performed procedure. With better understanding of immunology, which we have been talking today a lot, from 1963, the lung transplantation came into being. So these were the large incisions, huge incisions, which gave a memorable kind of pain and remembrance, a scar, difficulty in infections, and several other problems to the patient, a large incision which was there. Along the line also came improvement in surgical techniques, like the surgical, you can see here that when you have a disease which involves a vessel, but leaving the distal part, otherwise all right, you can actually do a complete and complex sleeve resection on either the left side or on the right side, sometimes even involving the carina. So technical improvement were taking. Mind you, everything of what you're seeing now has happened in the, only in the past 50 years. So this is very, very important. And these are the segmented resections where the understanding, biological understanding came that at least 2 centimeter safe margin has to accompany by a lymph node dissection for successful cure of the lung cancer treatment. The next important thing when we talk in terms of the evolution of lung cancer treatment is the minimally invasive surgery, as what we see, which has become a standard of care. I mentioned that in 1939, Jacobius was the first man he developed thoracoscopy as a diagnostic technique for inspection of pleural cavity, and he used rigid cystoscope under local anesthesia with a candle as a light source on the other side. And he mentioned three important factors. One is there has to be a minimal tissue trauma and pain, use of transparent medium in the cavity. So you can put water, but nothing more than that. And the need for a scope thin enough to be placed through the trocar. In 1992, the first major meeting on VATS was held in conjunction with the Society of Thoracic Surgeons. This is first time where people started getting organized for improving VATS. We had already done a first presentation in 1983 of 14 patients of diagnostic thoracoscopy for dilemmatic pleural effusion. This was presented at the Chennai ASI meeting in India. 1992, Louis was the first surgeon to report a large series of 100 consecutive patients who underwent VATS lobectomies using four ports without rib spreading, stapling the hilar structure simultaneously without isolation. I interacted with the gentleman himself, very dynamic, very, very erudite kind of a speaker. All that he would do is like putting a snare around that entire lobe and just staple it off. There was no lymph node dissection. There was nothing except that he chose his cases very carefully so that, you know, his survivals were almost very good. I would say that they were pretty good and comparable with the data available at those days. So from 93 to 2000, safety of hilar dissection in closed chest, adequacy of oncological outcomes and cost were some of the concerns voiced at this particular time about thoracoscopy itself. The maneuverability of the instruments in a closed chest, the inability to, you know, actually touch and have the feel was also a problem. We did our first right middle lobectomy by VATS at the Tata Memorial Hospital using only two ports, one for the instrument and one for videoscope in 2000 October. You can use a stapler of this kind, and it's a very comfortable and convenient way of doing a lobectomy. So there was a lot of talk which went on in the early 2000s. And from 2000 to 2014, the CALGB trial 31001 of 127 patients identified the issues of trial, which were avoidance of rib spreading, incision for specimen removal not to exceed 8 centimeters, individual dissection of vein, artery, and bronchus as described by Mackinnon, and standardized lymph node sampling. And this trial result proved the advantages of VATS over traditional thoracotomy. VATS was proved to reduce the pain, decreases recovery time, decreases duration of chest tube use, decreases length of stay, minimizes complications, and improve post-operative quality of life. Some of these points are very relevant here. Some are not relevant considering the cost differences in the United States. It is also associated with decreased effect on immune functions, potentially leading to improved long-term survival in lung cancer patients. So if at all we need to do any surgery on a patient who has been treated with immunotherapy, maybe VATS would be a better way of going. Because of the low risk and excellent outcomes, now it's going to be difficult for a new technology to supplant VATS, minimally invasive surgery, as a standard of care for pulmonary lobectomy. So successful cases of chest wall resection, bronchoplasty, sleeve resection, and pulmonary arterioplasty also have been reported. VATS segmentectomy in for all anatomical segments can be actually be done. This is reported with decreased blood loss, pulmonary complications, and length of stay. So from 2015, even the conventional VATS has undergone improvement. There are now needle scopic VATS where instruments of 2 to 3 millimeters in diameter and maybe about 5 millimeters scope can actually be used. So there'll be practically no spreading of the nerves at all, even through the port itself. And routinely now, there are centers in China, like in Shanghai, where they do 15,000 lung surgeries in a year, 80 to 100 surgeries every single day. They use two ports for VATS lobectomies, one utility port for instruments and one camera port, exactly like what we did about 20 years back. Now the way to go is going to be from 2010, the uniportal VATS is coming up, and it is 1 3 to 5 centimeter incision in the anterior axial line of the fifth interspace involving placement of thoracoscope and all instruments through this port. So the assistant and the surgeon both have to really do very well. And that is very, very important. You can see here that resections of this kind can be done. The mediastinal lymph node dissection can be done as well. And that has actually led to the evolution of robotic assisted thoracic surgery. The system came into existence from 2002 itself. Most limitations of VATS are overcome, like the depth perception, maneuverability, which gives hand-like movements and more. Technology of introduction of infrared light with autofluorescent agent visualization, etc. for major sublobar resection. The major limitations are only the cost, both for initial investment as well as purchasing of the consumable instruments. You can see here that this is a robotic resection being done. So where do we stand today in 2021? The standard of care has come to be now a lobectomy or a pneumonectomy if so required. Mediastinal lymph node dissection, still trials are going on about anything less than that. Selected patients who are over-functioned can undergo segmentectomy. Minimally invasive wherever possible, as far as possible. Screening for lung cancer is becoming slowly and steadily becoming a standard of care. At least in the US now, it has become very common. Hopefully in India also, it will come through within the next 5 or 10 years. Use of adjuvant chemotherapy has become routine after 1995. Now targeted therapy is slowly gaining ground after Adura, and immunotherapy is also gaining ground fast. So what has this whole progress contributed? You can read here that the evolution of lung cancer surgery has contributed to the sharpest drop in overall Congress mortality. Practically a 2.2% mortality because of cancer has been singly contributed by improvement in the lung cancer treatment. So this is a wonderful progress. And as thoracic surgeons, we are very, very happy. And as thoracic oncologists, I'm sure you'll share the happiness itself. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Deshpande, for a nice presentation, how you developed, how the development of the lung cancer surgery has happened. I remember my days of the residency when my professor of medicine told to one of the social activists that you go and get the operated from the general surgeon for your father's cancer lung. So he was quite furious and he replied, the professor of the surgery is quite bold to operate on my father. So he told Kano. Those days then the professor of medicine was trembling because he was quite furious. So those days we have seen, and we have seen your surgery started in the 2000, the Tata Hospital to 2020. So it's good. Any questions from the audience?
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Then the next speaker is the Dr. Vijay Anand Reddy. He is the director of Apollo Cancer Institute, Hyderabad, and he will talk the new innovation of radiation therapy of lung cancer. Dr. Reddy.
Are you able to see my slides, please?
Yes.
Right. So I was asked to talk about new innovations in radiation oncology. Okay. Now, see, I didn't know what the new innovations that we are looking at, but what I could understand is the new indications. A new way of sequencing chemo versus radiation therapy, new techniques and new technology. Now, so the role of RT in cancer lung, the new indications, I would say slowly as the definitive RT for stage 1, stage 2 lung cancer has come in a big way. We call it as SBRT or ablative radiation therapy. In a stage 4 in a metastatic CA lung, consolidation local RT after giving systemic chemotherapy has shown to improve this overall survival. Coming back to the SBRT, we all know SBRT was only advised if the patient was medically inoperable in the past. Now look at the trials of RTOG and JCOG, a Japanese trial, where they have shown people who are not inoperable for medical reasons were only referred, and they have shown equally good results on par with the surgery, almost 5 year survival of 93%. And this is a Japanese study where they could show almost same 90% 3 years control rate. Most of these are retrospective data, and the limitations is that most of them are patients who had some comorbid conditions which were not possible to operate. So surgical cohorts were definitely younger, and they had very few comorbidities. And in spite of that, the SBRT results were on par with the surgical results. People tried to do phase 3 trials to prove that SBRT is equally good, but unfortunately, due to lack of consensus, the recruitment was very poor, and all the three trials were closed prematurely. However, they could compare the SBRT two randomized phase 3 studies where surgery was compared with SBRT on a different group. They are not in direct comparison though, but they could see that the first 1 year and 3 years were almost similar, actually were superior in SBRT group compared to surgical group. So 100 to 88%, and 3 years was 95 to 79% against surgery. So relapse free survival also better with SBRT. So then they looked at patients who were operable with this data. Some of the patients who were even operable were opted for SBRT, that is ablative radiation therapy, in stage 1 and stage 2. And they could see that there's no difference in cancer-specific survival and local failure and distant mets as well. So this is our own experience of 26 patients, and between 2015 and 2020, total number of patients were 26. Average age, median age was 66 years, and the median follow-up was 35 months. Only two patients progressed, and so gratifying results, out of 26, only two patients had progression locally and also in the mediastinal lymph nodes. So this is how the pre-SBRT and post-SBRT is quite gratifying, and it's so encouraging to advise patients in stage 1, stage 2 CL lung. SBRT is very promising, and it is, I feel that it's a definitive alternative, although it has not become a standard of care in any of the NCCN guidelines or ESMO guidelines, but certainly this should be considered, and probably only prospective randomized studies would let us know. Now coming to stage 3A and stage 3BC, there are a lot of discussion of chemotherapy versus radiation or concurrent chemo radiation therapy, whether to give neoadjuvant followed by radiation. So, but we let me not get into several trials which are done in the past, but go to the Cochrane review, which was around 2,393 patients, and they could see that the concurrent chemo-RT is far superior than neoadjuvant chemotherapy followed by radiation. That was presented in 2004. Subsequently, in 2010, several other trials were included, 25 randomized studies, and they could see whether sequential chemo followed by radiation is better than concurrent chemo radiation. And they also could see that overall survival was much superior in concurrent arm, and recurrence of progression-free survival were also superior in concurrent chemotherapy arm versus sequential chemo followed by radiation. So if you add chemotherapy to radiation concurrently, there is 8% absolute survival benefit. And when you do concurrent against sequential, there is 10% absolute survival benefit at 2 years with a hazard ratio of 0.74. Now that has become a standard of care. Either a preoperative treatment, you need to go for chemo radiation in stage 3A. And if it is stage 3B, also that it is concurrent chemo radiation as a standard of care in all the stage 3A or stage 3B lung cancer. This is again in N3 node positive cases, it is definitive concurrent chemo radiation. So this is what I was trying to tell you, a new indication that RT in stage 4, consolidation RT after systemic treatment in a metastatic non-small cell lung cancer improves survival significantly, 41 months versus 17 months. You just leave the patient without consolidated radiation. Now that has become a standard of care as a definitive thoracic radiation after systemic chemotherapy in stage 4 lung cancer. So what dose is optimal? We know about this, and the old trial which has shown that 60 gray is superior than 50 gray. And this is an RTOG trial way back, almost 50 years back. Now they try to improve the same RTOG trial which was published in 2011. Shall we increase the dose to 74? unfortunately that has become detrimental, but more, we should all understand that this radiation which was done were 3D conformal, and then they have kind of radiation pneumonitis. So 74 gray is no good over 60 gray. That was a conclusion way back in 2011. This is a kind of radiation pneumonitis that you develop if you do 2D CRT or 3D CRT. And how to prevent this? Then you need to know what is the tolerance dose of a normal lung to prevent radiation pneumonitis. And this is what it is. Volume of the lung, 20% of the volume of the lung should be getting less than 30 to 40% of the total dose. So the so this is V20 has to be less than 35% to 40%. Then only you can prevent radiation pneumonitis. So the V20, the volume of the lung getting 20 gray, should be less than 35 to 40. And especially if they're elderly people, it should be even much less when they are using taxane chemotherapy. So how to do that? They're now in the new innovative techniques that are. The first thing is a PET CT scan, which can easily collapse lung with the tumor. So we automatically, the volume delineation would help us to avoid the collapsed lung. So the reduced amount of radiation would, PET CT helps in reducing the volume of lung radiation. Now the new technology from 2D, 3D CRT. This is a kind of radiation pneumonitis that you see if you do 2D or 3D CRT, and that we moved from there to IMRT, where you see dose is confirmed around the tumor and very less radiation to the rest of the lung. From 3D CRT, we moved on to IMRT, and obviously there will be dose conformity in all these areas. So the V20 is significantly much less. If you look at the graph, 3D CRT, a significant increase in the dose of almost V20 is more than 40%, and obviously IMRT has reduced that. A volumetric arc has significantly reduced V20 and V30. So the other techniques to reduce the dose to the lung is breath hold technique. So you release the radiation only when the patient is holding the breath, when the tumor comes into the area of radiation. Although relatively simple and efficient, but it has an inconsistent pattern. So then we moved on to the respiratory gating, where the mission itself will get adjusted, and the movement of the lung, whenever the tumor comes into that area, then only the radiation beam is released. So this is called respiratory gating. With all the new technology, all the major institutes have got this technology. Then we got 4D CT. Then we take 1 millimeter cuts while the patient is taking inhales and exhales. And then that is called representing 10 phases. Then we get a composite images that will tell us the area where the tumor is. This is the maximum intensity projection of the tumor. Almost 30 to 70% of the times the tumor is seen in this area. So combination of 4D CT and MIP, then we can reduce the overall normal lung radiation, because the target is mainly that where the tumor, even with the movement, we know where the tumor is. So with the, using this 4D CT and IMRT, we're able to increase the overall survival and reduce the grade 3 toxicity. So the hype, the recent one is a proton beam therapy. The great advantage of this is there's no exit dose. So obviously the normal lung would get reduced radiation. So this is how the exit dose is much less here. The tumor gets maximum dose with the proton beam therapy. So with the proton, again, significant reduction in the dose to the lung as well as to the heart with proton beam therapy. So it is quite superior compared to IMRT. The dose to the normal lung can be reduced with the proton therapy. Of course, it comes with a huge cost. And conclusion, with the high technology, we're able to reduce the V20, volume of the lung getting radiation would be reduced. So IGRT, IMRT significantly reduces. SRS and SBRT, dose escalation is possible and promising role in early stage tumors. Palliative SBRT in isolated metastasis. Proton beam therapy is definitely superior in terms of reducing the morbidity and reducing the dose to the normal lung. And PET CT, 4D CT and MIP again helps in volume delineation of appropriate lung and reducing the a normal lung in the volume of radiation. So, but you should always be cautious when you're treating elderly people, and especially when you have COPD and you have a lower lobe lesions, then you'd have a bulky mediastinal lymph nodes. Again, significant amount of normal lung would be radiated. Radiation pneumonitis could be a possibility. So you should be very, very careful and take with a pinch of salt when you're treating this kind of patients. Conclusions, innovations in RT for non-small cell lung cancer, SBRT in stage 1 and 2, concurrent chemo radiation is a standard of care. Consolidation RT is feasible and helps in overall improving the overall survival in stage 4. Dose has to be as of now 60 to 66 gray. In case if you want to increase, use SBRT only to the lung, not to the mediastinum. And technological innovation with IMRT, IGRT and volumetric arc when proton therapy helps in better conformity, reduces volume of lung getting 20 gray and reduces radiation pneumonitis. And breath holding, 4D CT, MIP for tumor volume delineation reduces the normal lung in the field of radiation. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Dr. Reddy, for a nice presentation and the role of the radiation in the lung cancer. And any question from the audience? No question, then we should move ahead and there should be a debate in surgery versus stereotactic radiotherapy for early stage non-small cell lung cancer. And from surgeon side, I invite Dr.
Bhatti. Can I interject here, please? So, you know, I think the debate is not there. I believe the surgeon is not available. Is that right, Suman?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So I think after two masterly talks, one by Dr. Deshpande and then by Dr. Vijayanand Reddy, I think I'm told that more than 350 delegates are attending the deliberations of this conference. So I think we all learned quite a lot as to how the surgery and the radiation has evolved. I think the next talk is, Dr. Bhatti, now you can introduce Dr. Kundan for the next talk on the subject of radiation.
So Kundan will speak on the stereotactic RT. He's a radiation oncologist and he's chief of the breast and the thoracic radiation oncology, Rajiv Gandhi Cancer Institute, Delhi.
So, good evening, everyone. Am I audible and can everybody can see my screen?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. There was a nice deliberation by Dr. Deshpande and Dr. Reddy with regard to surgical and the radiation aspect. So at the outset, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. And earlier, the point of discussion here was surgery or SBRT in early stage non-small cell lung cancer. Unfortunately, Dr. Tanveer is not able to make it today because of some health issues and would like to wish him a speedy recovery. And fortunately, I will not have to favor SBRT just for the sake of debate. So that is also a point here. So I will be balanced in my statements here. So I will begin by stating that surgery is definitely the standard of care for medically operable non-small cell lung cancer. So I will be illustrating the role of SBRT in this particular situation and how it fares when it is pitched against surgery, especially for early stage lung cancer. So why are we having this discussion when we already have surgery as a standard of care in many guidelines? While considering these guidelines, I would like to highlight here that not recommended doesn't mean non-efficacious. So in next few minutes, I would present the evidence showing efficacy of SBRT as compared to surgery and how SBRT is advantageous when considering cons of surgery procedures. So talking about evidence, here is the evidence, though not a level one evidence, but is a prospective good quality evidence for medically operable patients. This is specifically for medically operable patients with long-term, quite a decent long-term follow-up data, which is in the tune of more than 50 months and impressive, not 3 years, but a 5 year survival, almost as good as surgical series. So if we compare the results of various individual series of surgery and SBRT, we can very clearly see that SBRT approaches the same efficacy as of surgical series with regard to overall survival or local control. Although local control is defined by surgical literature variably and includes recurrence occurring within the same lobe, sometimes another lobe within the same ipsilateral lung, or hilar recurrence and sometimes ipsilateral mediastinal lymph nodes. While local control is defined by RT literature as control within 1 centimeter around PTV. So it's not very prudent to compare the local control, but the survival definitely is almost matching with the surgical series. There were two randomized trials comparing surgery with SBRT, but unfortunately couldn't complete because of poor accrual, and will not go into details and reasons for poor accrual as Dr. Reddy has already discussed that. Fortunately, there was meta-analysis of these two incomplete trials published in a reputed journal, the Lancet journal, stating that overall survival is better in SBRT arm. And this was outrightly rejected by the surgeons, stating many flaws, one of them being very few patients. But just to remind my dear surgeon colleagues that what was the comparative data of surgery versus radiation, which made surgery as a standard of care. So if we go back, way back in 1963, almost with same number of patients published in same journal, there was a randomized trial establishing the efficacy of surgery over radiation. Although RT at that time was ultra conventional as compared to today's time and technology, but it's ironical that your reasons for refusal are same as your reasons for acceptance. So when considering surgical approach, let's answer these questions. Do we have phase 3 randomized trials stating advantage of surgery over SBRT? The answer is clear-cut no. Is surgery standard of care? And despite of no level 1 evidence comparing surgery with SBRT, the answer is yes. So what is the rationale behind this approach? Because way back in past when there was suboptimal radiation technique. Because of this, I completely agree that surgery was definitely the better option at that particular time. But the time has changed and this same standard of care is being continued now. So the standard treatment always cannot be considered as the best choice for all patients. So not recommended doesn't mean contradicted. And why I am so will come to it later. So meanwhile, let's see the quality of data favoring both the approaches. So if we exclude meta-analysis of two incomplete phase 3 randomized trials favoring SBRT, then there is exactly the same kind of literature available for both the approaches, and only difference being a longer follow-up data for surgery. Not because it's better than SBRT, but it was better than conventional radiation, and thus was having its presence for more than 5 decades, while SBRT is comparatively a new entrant. Now let's see what exactly SBRT is. It is, I'll not go into detail. Dr. Reddy has already mentioned it. It is a highly conformal technique with large dose per fraction and limited number of total fractions usually, which is less than 5 fractions. And with techniques like breath hold and tumor tracking, motion is not a problem, and we can safely deliver very, very high doses of radiation to the target lesion. And with risk adapted approaches where we increase the fractionation minimally, while keeping the radiobiological radiation doses above 100, one can treat central as well as ultra-central lesions safely with utmost precision and with same efficacy. So with this background of precision and efficacy, let's come back to the discussion. And I think this is the latest systematic review and meta-analysis which complements surgery as a better option to SBRT. I think this was published in 2019, very recently, in terms of survival for overall population, as well as for the propensity scored matched analysis. So this was really a very exhaustive and a very well-conducted analysis. And I'm sure if Dr. Tanvir would have been around, and he would have definitely mentioned about this particular meta-analysis or systematic review. But there were some concluding remarks which were absolutely irrelevant, and I will counter them point by point. So this conclusion that surgery is associated with a better clinical outcome is doubtful and seriously flawed. The overall survival associated with SBRT in medically operable patients reported in this study was much poorer than that reported by many authors like Onishi et al, Nagata et al, and Chang et al. There are many. So I've just mentioned 3. And in all these studies, age was excluded from the inclusion criteria, and the highest age which was treated was 80 years. And still, the OS was much higher than that reported in this meta-analysis. Furthermore, the overall survival associated with SBRT in medically operable patient in this meta-analysis was inferior to that in inoperable patients in JCOG 0403 study, as reported by Nagata et al., which was again a very well-conducted study. And there was a 50% overall survival in this meta-analysis versus 60% in that in the study by Nagata et al. For medically inoperable. So we are comparing medically inoperable with a medically operable patients. The reason for worse overall survival for SBRT in this meta-analysis may be the presence of medically inoperable patients in SBRT subgroup, which were classified incorrectly as medically operable, and I will come to that. Contrastingly, Zeng et al. In their systematic review and meta-analysis reported a completely reverse result as compared to this meta-analysis. So my point here is one can find systematic reviews and meta-analysis as per their beliefs. And really, it really depends what one wants to see. So therefore, I was quite intrigued by the findings of Chen et al., where they reported that overall survival depends on the first author speciality in a meta-analysis of propensity scored studies. So there is clearly an element of bias in these so-called highest level of evidence available to us, whether it being for radiation or it being for surgery. Another remark which was there was imbalance in baseline characteristic in both the groups. And I agree, this was a very precise expression. So performance status and frailty are not fully matched in most propensity score matching studies. And medical operability is just differently by institutions and physicians. So a few patients in SBRT cohort who were judged as being medically operable would have had different physical status compared to that of patients in surgical cohort. For example, based on National Cancer Database coding, which is a database where most of the authors has taken data and done the analysis comparing SBRT with surgery. That's why I'm quoting this. So as per the National Cancer Database coding, a patient with peptic ulcer and rheumatologic disease would have a higher Charlson Duo score of 2 than a patient with chronic pulmonary disease, which will have a score of 1. So this disconnect likely explains why SBRT patients paradoxically had the comorbidity scores superior to surgical patients in these kind of analysis, as shown by Ajmani et al., when performance status would almost certainly favor the surgical cohort based on the treatment recommendations of the national guidelines. So another remark which was made was with regard to histopathology, but it doesn't hold any ground, as all the studies I have quoted in my previous slides, they show the efficacy of SBRT and they had an histopathology proven patients. So although there is a data shown by Vergen et al. that there is no difference between pathologically proven and unproven cohorts, on the contrary, confirmation of histopathology before surgery is more important because ground glass nodularities are generally proven to be non-invasive or minimally invasive tumor and thus results in better survival for surgical cohort. So any treatment which has been there for the longest time periods after a comparison study is considered as the standard of care, but standard treatment cannot be considered as best choice for all patients. So selection of SBRT for operable early stage non-small cell lung cancer patients who prefer SBRT over surgery as a patient's choice, it should be and it is considered as acceptable and reasonable. And following these principles, there was a change in pattern of practices across US, and Huck et al. Reported an increase in radiotherapy utilization and a decrease in surgical utilization for treatment of early stage non-small cell lung cancer after radiation oncologist incorporated SBRT as a treatment option in the United States. So what do we have? The same quality data supports both the approaches. Considering SBRT as a non-invasive approach with minimal toxicity and morbidity and excellent outcome evident by high local control rates and equivalent survival. So I would like to make points here that along with medically inoperable patients, if a medically operable patient prefers SBRT over surgery, it is reasonable to offer it with proper consent. And there were 4 ongoing randomized trials out of which one has reported result. And this was very interesting that this trial, Sabertooth, which the purpose of this trial was to assess the feasibility of phase 3 randomized trial of SBRT versus surgery in early stage high-risk patient for surgery. So they were assessing the feasibility and it was found that this approach was not feasible because majority of patients, they had a predefined decisions that what treatment they want to undergo. So 41% of the patients, they preferred SBRT. and 18% preferred surgery, and thus they declined their participation in the study. So high-risk patients, most preferred choice of treatment is SBRT. And once again, I would like to emphasize that surgery definitely is a standard of care, but SBRT is an option in operable patients also with an early stage non-small cell lung cancer, even from the viewpoint of evidence-based medicine, as I have already shown in my previous slides, as the data I have quoted here. And SBRT can be applied in clinical practice based on the patient's choice. So SBRT definitely should be examined in clinical trial as well as through meta-analysis and propensity matched studies. And we eagerly await the results of these three phase three randomized trials. So coming to the current context of immunotherapy, several studies have observed that radiation-induced anti-tumor immunity might be dose-dependent, with relatively higher dose being more powerful immunologic adjuvants. The superiority of SBRT to conventional radiotherapy makes it more favorable to combine with the PD-1 and PD-L1 inhibitors to achieve better survival benefits. And there are many phase 2 and phase 3 ongoing trial testing this hypothesis, though there are many unanswered questions till date, like what would be the optimal sequencing, what will be the optimal irradiated volumes, what will be the optimal dose, and many more like this. But I think we all agree that advances in PD-1 and PD-L1 inhibitors have resulted in a paradigm shift in the management of patients with non-small cell lung cancer. Nonetheless, immune escape and immune resistance limit their antitumor effect in majority of patients. The non-invasive, well-tolerated SBRT could substantially modulate the tumor microenvironment to further make tumors more sensitive to PD-1 and PD-L1 inhibitors, which depicts a promising landscape of the synergistic combination treatment for non-small cell lung cancer. So to my knowledge, the published data, though limited, indicate that the combination treatment has considerable promise in future non-small cell lung cancer treatment, and we all eagerly await the result of these ongoing trials. Thank you. Thanks.
Excellent, Dr. Kundan. I really appreciate the talk. I fully agree with you that we should always give an option to those patients who are presenting in stage 1, stage 2, giving them the equal opportunity to go for a non-invasive procedure like SBRT. Although we don't have the consensus, unfortunately, in NCCN or ESMO or NICE guidelines, it doesn't give an option. But they won't say, as you rightly said, not contraindicated to go for SBRT. Unless we get some kind of at least an option of SBRT in these guidelines, it's very difficult to convince a patient to go for an SBRT. Very nice presentation, Dr. Kundan.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Next, we will invite Dr. Meenu Walia. She is the director and HOD of the Medical Oncology, Max Institute of Cancer Center, Delhi. And she will speak on newer paradigm in the treatment of the resected, EGFR mutated early lung cancer. Dr. Meenu Walia.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for a warm introduction. Let me just open my slides. So what I'm going to talk about is the adjuvant treatment of resected EGFR mutant early lung cancer. So what's new in this field? So lung cancer, we know, is not only one of the commonest cancer, rather the most common cancer all over the world, but it is also the most lethal cancer all over the world. It causes more than 1.7 million deaths annually and much more deaths than the next three common cancers put together. It causes more deaths than breast, prostate, and colorectal cancers put together. Majority of these lung cancer cases are, of course, non-small cell lung cancer, with approximately, if we take the data from the Western world also, 30% of the patients they present with an early disease or at the time of diagnosis. So talking about lung cancer, we have a early stage or localized lung cancer, or we have a regional or locally advanced lung cancer. So these are the few early stages where, yes, surgery can be considered. Stage 1, stage 2, and stage 3, and probably a selected subset of stage 3B also. So 30% of the patients may present with an early stage lung cancer where surgery can be considered. And however, although surgery is the primary treatment for these early stage lung cancers, we know that even before the adjuvant, for a very, very long time, even in this stage of those early cancers, more than half of these patients would invariably relapse and will go on to die from the disease. So adjuvant chemotherapy changed a lot for this group of patients. So recommended for all the patients in today's date with resected stage 1B, selected 1B onwards, stage 2 and stage 3 non-small cell lung cancer, and selected 1B also. We have results from various randomized trials and meta-analysis also that there is a definite OS benefit also with adjuvant chemotherapy in patients in this subgroup of operated lung cancer patients in the adjuvant setting. However, in spite of all this, the disease recurrence or death following surgery and even after adjuvant chemotherapy remains high across these early stage groups also. So even if it is a stage 1B, we see that almost 45% of these patients will have, in spite of adjuvant chemotherapy, a recurrence. And the same goes for stage 2 and stage 3, with rates increasing to approximately 60% and 70%. Based on whatever limited number of studies that we have, so talking about today's date, we know that not all lung cancers are the same. Not all non-small cell lung cancers and not all adenocarcinomas are also the same. So EGFR, talking about that particular subset of patients which are EGFR mutant lung cancer patients. So is EGFR a mutation which is present only in advance or probably develops when the cancer becomes advanced, or the mutation is present even as has been found, is the prevalence different in the early stage lung cancer patients or not? So across whatever data we have, what has been found is that the prevalence seems to be irrespective of the stage of the disease at presentation. So even for those subgroup of patients who present with an early stage disease, there seems to be a prevalence of EGFR mutation to the tune of 40 to 50%. And this remains, the percentage is almost the same across the stages, whether it is a stage 2, stage 3 or stage 4. You have among the Asian population, the estimated prevalence is to the tune of approximately 40%, as contrast with the Caucasians where it is 10 to 20%. So possibly extrapolating this data, there might be, that was the initial thought process, so there might be the benefits of TKIs or these EGFR directed therapies in this subgroup of patients also. And that was the main idea, main thought process behind the ADAURA trial. So where osimertinib was tried as an adjuvant therapy in patients of stage 1B and stage 3A, across stage 1B to stage 3A, EGFR mutant population, non-squamous, non-small cell lung cancer after complete tumor resection. So this was the study design. The patients were basically all adult patients with performance status 0 to 1, confirmed with a histopathological diagnosis, confirmed non-squamous, non-small cell lung cancer, primary lung cancer, with an EGFR mutation, exon 19. The EGFR mutation specifically being either exon 19 deletion or a L858R deletion. Brain imaging was done in all these patients before subjecting them to surgery. And the criteria of inclusion was complete resection with negative margins. And patients were randomized at least within 10 weeks in case they had not received adjuvant chemotherapy, and within 26 weeks if they had received adjuvant chemotherapy. Further stratification was done on the basis of stage, on the basis of the type of EGFR mutation, and on the basis of race. So that was one-to-one randomization. Osimertinib 80 mg was given in the one arm versus placebo. And the primary endpoint was disease-free survival. And the secondary endpoint was the disease-free survival at 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, and the overall survival, apart from the health and quality of life issues. So again, repeating the inclusion criteria. So there had to be a central confirmation of the EGFR mutation, exon 19 or L858R mutation. Patients who were eligible for the study was irrespective whether they received adjuvant chemotherapy or not. So the standard adjuvant, in case they received the adjuvant chemotherapy, so it was the standard adjuvant chemotherapy, basically a platinum-based doublet for 4 cycles maximum. They were allowed, but not mandatory. So patients who did not receive adjuvant were also eligible for the study. Complete surgical resection was one of the inclusion criteria. Baseline MRI or PET scan brain imaging was done, and patients with an excellent performance status. So all patients who had received either preoperative radiation or chemotherapy, radiation even postoperative were excluded. If the patient had earlier received an EGFR TKI, the patient was excluded. And patients who elapsed the time period more than 10 weeks in the absence of adjuvant chemotherapy, or more than 26 weeks in the absence of more than 5 to 6 months in the absence of adjuvant chemotherapy were also excluded from the study. So patients who have had only segmentectomies or wedge resections were also excluded. Possibly the patient with a lower tumor or a favorable disease burden, so that to maintain that homogeneity, were excluded from the study. And or any patient with any other uncontrolled systemic disease or ILD were excluded from the study. So if we have a closer look between the two subgroups, and we will see the two subgroups were quite matched as far as the distribution of male-female ratio, smoking Asians versus non-Asians. And they were almost quite matched. And another important thing which I wanted to bring attention to was that it was almost 60% of the patient who received adjuvant chemotherapy in both the arms, placebo versus osimertinib. So 60% had actually received adjuvant chemotherapy. So this was the osimertinib disease-free survival, and we can see, there was a wide separation of the graphs, and this was only in stage 2 and 3A, and this was in the stage, includes that stage 1B also, that selected subset. So, and the hazards ratio, is something which I'll say probably needs attention. It was 0.17. I mean, these are the kind of hazards ratio, I think all the oncologists will agree with me, are very, very rare that we find these convincing hazards ratio in our oncology trials. So 0.17, and in the overall population was also 0.20, meaning that approximately 80% of the patients benefited. So there was the risk reduction to the tune of 83%. In the primary population, overall 80% risk reduction if we had included the early stage 1B subset also. And the risk reduction, the 2-year disease-free survival, if we see, was definitely better versus the placebo all across the stages, whether it was a stage 1B, stage 2 or a stage 3. And we had very convincing hazards ratio figures, and as the stage advances, the benefit seems to be higher. So approximately 80% of the patient benefiting in the stage 2 and stage 3A disease. So again, the forest plot for the same, and seeing again the benefits across, osimertinib seems to be performing much better, and we looking at everything seems to be plotted across on the osimertinib site. So irrespective of whether it was male or female, irrespective of the age, 65, elderly or in the younger, irrespective of the smoking history, irrespective of the Asian versus Caucasians or non-Asians, and irrespective of the stage also, 1B, 2, and 3A, we see everything seems to be favoring the osimertinib arm. And irrespective of the exon 19 deletion or the type of EGFR mutation, L858R, again, and irrespective of the adjuvant chemotherapy also, whether the patient had received adjuvant chemotherapy or not, no adjuvant chemotherapy, the benefit seems to be favoring the osimertinib arm. So this is what disease-free survival, and I think most of us will agree on the fact that DFS in oncology trials seems to be a reasonable outcome achievement at this point of time. The early snapshot for overall survival seems to be favorable at this point of time. So what is, just to have a look at what is our status about about these EGFR targeted therapies in the adjuvant setting from previous trials that we have. So we have been had some previous trials also. However, the evidence had never translated into approval or change in clinical practice in the adjuvant setting, whatever we had earlier than this. And I'll come to that later. So we had this SELECT trial where erlotinib was given in the adjuvant setting. And yes, there was a disease-free survival compared to the placebo group. And we had the RADIANT and the IVAN. Majority of these trials were done only with erlotinib, and DFS was found in all across in majority of these trials. No benefit of OS was found in any of these trials. And there was one trial where gefitinib has also been used in the adjuvant setting, where it was a negative trial, but it was not it failed to show superiority. Apart from in today's date, yes, do we say that all TKIs are same? So we have enough evidence to say that yes, all TKIs are not the same. We have first generation, second generation, and third generation. And it will be reasonably to say probably osimertinib seems to be a very potent, or rather the most potent TKI at present. Maybe that explains the difference and the so convincing data that we are finding in this adjuvant setting with ADAURA trial. Apart from what in the small subgroup of patient where the disease recurred also, the type of recurrence that was seen was also something which was very encouraging. So what the type of majority of the cases had local recurrence, and if at all there was distant recurrence, it was not the CNS recurrences. So CNS recurrence, we all agree, is something that is most dreaded in all these cancer patients, and the outcome seems to be not very good with that subgroup of patient where brain mets or CNS recurrence take place. And the CNS was a common site of distant recurrence in the EGFR mutant population receiving TKIs in the earlier adjuvant trials. For example, in the adjuvant RADIANT trial also, 37% of these recurrences with erlotinib had occurred in the brain and the CNS. So possibly the higher penetration, the higher levels that osimertinib crosses the blood-brain barrier and receives in the brain has a reason that the CNS recurrences were seen to be a significantly lower extent with this trial. So the type of, again, just zooming on to the type of disease recurrence. So within the osimertinib arm, so out of these recurrences, we see the CNS recurrences was actually much more less compared to the placebo arm, where there seems to be 60% of the patients in the placebo arm had distant metastatic recurrences. Coming to, again, this is just in an extrapolation of earlier slide only, that having a pattern of the recurrences, One is overall recurrence is much less with osimertinib compared to the placebo. And among these recurrences also, we see the CNS recurrence was definitely much more less compared to the placebo. And also historical comparison also much more than any of the earlier predecessors which has been used in the adjuvant setting. Going further, any trial, all these trials, especially when we are talking about the adjuvant setting, a very important aspect remains is the safety or the toxicity profile, because these medicines being given in a patient who are otherwise asymptomatic. So adverse events, yes, slightly more on the osimertinib arm compared to the placebo. But if we see the adverse events which were possibly causally related as put in by the investigators, grade 3 events were considerably less. So slightly more on the osimertinib arm compared to the placebo arm, but it was a very small percentage of patients which had these grade 3 events, and hardly any patient had a serious adverse event. So, and among the side effects that were seen, so the most common being the diarrhea and skin and nail changes being the commonest. Grade 1-2 interstitial lung disease was seen in a very small subgroup of patients, just 3% of the patient in the osimertinib arm. So none of these side effects were grade 4. And this is what was finally published also. Osimertinib as adjuvant therapy for resected EGFR mutated non-small cell lung cancer. The another thought process was, has chemotherapy, I mean, in the era where we all seems to be giving stage 2 and stage 3 post-operative, where there's a definite role of adjuvant chemotherapy. So do we think of replacing osimertinib at this point of time, or osimertinib is an add-on to chemotherapy? Too early to say that, but adjuvant chemotherapy, going back to the data, we see that in this study also, 60% of the patients had actually received adjuvant chemotherapy. The standard adjuvant chemotherapy, platinum-based chemotherapy, and all these patients had received minimum 4 cycles of chemotherapy. And if you look at across the stages, so stage 2 and stage 3, almost 70 to 80% of the patients had received adjuvant chemotherapy. In the subgroup of stage 1B, also 26% of these patients had received adjuvant chemotherapy.
Dr. Menu, please conclude.
Yeah. I am basically, maybe a closer look at this graph will tell us that the benefit seems to be more if the patient had received adjuvant chemotherapy, but it might be if we, those who have received adjuvant chemotherapy were the slightly higher stage and probably higher risk group, and maybe the benefit seems to be more. I am not going into the details of this for the lack of time, but irrespective of adjuvant chemotherapy versus no adjuvant chemotherapy, there has been significant, we see the curves separating with not very frequently we see in an oncological studies such a wide separation of the curves. And as the stage increases, more seems to be the separation of the curves. So the stage 2 and stage 3 seems to be benefiting much more compared to the stage 1. Maybe possibly because the recurrence rate, we know that the higher the stage, the more is the recurrence rate. No discussion is complete without quality of life issues, and quality of life also, all these assays showed us that patients have a reasonably good quality of life as compared to the placebo. There were hardly any discomfort, neither physical or mental discomfort while on this adjuvant therapy. So these are my summary slides. Adjuvant osimertinib is the first targeted agent in the global trial to show statistically, not only statistically significant, but clinically meaningful improvement in disease-free survival in the post-operative selected stage 1B, 2, and 3A group of non-small cell lung cancer, EGFR mutant. And the risk reduction is to the tune of more than 80%, which were never, these kind of risk reductions we very rarely see. And plus, What is very encouraging is also there is also a clinically meaningful improvement in CNS disease-free survival, which is another good point that came, because this probably shows that osimertinib crosses a blood-brain barrier, and the safety profile was also, most of these patients received osimertinib for a median of 22 months, and this, and it was found to be the safety profile was quite tolerable, and the quality of life was also maintained. So adjuvant osimertinib is highly effective, and if you ask me, is it practice changing? Yes, possibly in today's date, I would rather it is practice changing. For this subgroup of patient, if cost is not an issue, then I would definitely want to give benefit of this to my this subgroup of patients. And with that, I say thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Meenu Walia, for a nice presentation. Now I will request Dr. Rajendra Toprani for word of wisdom.